Honorable Deputy Chief Minister of Bihar, my colleague Professor L. D'Souza, Dr. Govind Rao, who doesn't seem to be around, Dr. Mukherjee, Dr. Shaibal Gupta, other friends and co-panelists on the dais, friends and colleagues in the audience, and ladies and gentlemen, let me say that I'm very happy to be here at the ADRI organized event for the first time. I have been asked to speak on this burning issue of reforming agriculture markets in India. What I plan to do, because I was asked to give a talk on agriculture, but I chose to focus on this. So I plan to, within the given time frame I have, 30 to 35 minutes, to first highlight some of the major issues in the farm sector, which are being perceived as agrarian crisis or agrarian distress, and then some of the challenges which Indian agriculture faces at this juncture, and including the marketing challenges, and what is being planned at the policy level, both in terms of regulation as well as promotion or development of agricultural markets. I'm referring particularly to two new model acts, APLM, Agriculture Produce and Livestock Markets Act 2017, and Contract Farming and Services Act 2018. I'm also happy to be here because Bihar was one of the states in the last decade which took a call not to amend the act, but abolish the act altogether in 2006. And I was one of the participants in the meeting in Delhi where this was announced. So it's a very appropriate kind of place to talk about marketing reforms in the agriculture sector. Now, if I move on and share with you the fact that if we are talking about the agriculture sector today in India, there are all kinds of perceptions and perspectives on this. The first point I would like to highlight is that I feel, and I can prove that with evidence, that size of the farm is not an issue so far as viability of agriculture is concerned in this country or anywhere in the world. I've just done a paper as a memorial lecture delivered last month where I have given evidence from across the globe that corporate farming is not working. Wherever it emerged, it's declining. And small farms, including in India, have been found to be the most efficient in terms of producing the highest value of output per unit area. And I say this very often that it is not the size of the farm, but what you do on that farm, how you do, when you do, how much you do, for whom you do, and why you do, that's what makes it viable or unviable. We have carried out studies of what we call small farms but prosperous farmers, where we have farmers in India who operate, not necessarily own, but operate less than 5 acres of land and make anywhere between 100,000 rupees to 700,000 rupees per acre per year net profit. So I personally believe that there's a money in agriculture and agri-business. It's a different matter that the farmer is not able to make it. So we will not dwell on this issue further, that farm size is not a problem. The issue is that even if a farmer who has 5 acres in this country, in the given cropping pattern and other conditions of doing farming he or she has, he or she may not be able to get a good livelihood for a family of five. That is because the kind of cropping pattern which is there, if 60% of India grows just wheat and paddy on its gross cropped area, then you can only earn so much. Therefore, there is an issue of alternative sources of income, because already about 30 to 50% of smallholders' incomes come from dairying. And another 25% of the gross value added in the agriculture sector comes from horticulture sector. So horticulture and dairying together account for something like 45 to 50% total GDP of agriculture in this country. And even at the farmer level, farming is only about 50% of the total income a farmer earns from various sources. Therefore, farming is not the mainstay of farmers for themselves even. So there also it is, we should look beyond and look differently at agriculture. We all know the serious problems of inputs markets and output markets. I don't want to go into details of that except fertilizer subsidies, no state subsidy reaches the small and marginal farmers adequately. And I did this exercise of analyzing all the central and state government policies to look at what is there in these policies for marginal and small farmers, which is specially targeted at them. Other than the priority sector credit and the micro irrigation guidelines, one could not find much. We keep talking of small and marginal farmers, we keep talking in their name, but mostly policy design do not really adequately provide for their special interests. The issues of farmers can be addressed both in terms of production risk and market risk. And the problem here is that on both fronts, the policies are not able to do enough. If you look at crop insurance, it is not able to move beyond one third of the cropped area. There are serious issues in terms of implementation and so on. Of course, the new policy is much better than what we had in the past in terms of risk coverage. On the market side, there are missing markets, markets which don't offer remunerated prices. MSP system doesn't go beyond a few percentage of the farmers and a few states and a few crops. I call them 2.5 states and 3.5 crops. Yeah. So the issue is that we are not able to help the small farmers deal with markets, both in terms of buying as well as selling. And one of the ways to do that was to have farmer collectives. Unfortunately, they are also missing most of the time. Only about 2% of the farmers are member of any farmer association, and about 5% of any self-help group. And most of the self-help groups are not into farming. Actually, they are into other allied activities. And some of the so-called progressive states like Punjab, the picture is even dismal, 0.3 and 1.5%. So if we want farmers to fight or deal with modern markets, whether it's exporters, processors, supermarkets, multinationals, or whatever, or even large statal bodies, then we need to have platforms where farmers can deal with these buyers, bigger buyers, who tend to generally look for larger volumes, which only larger farmers can provide. The serious issue also is of the interlocking of markets. A lot of the indebtedness, a lot of the so-called farmer suicides are also because of the fact that even today, institutional credit accounts for only 60% total credit needs of the farm sector. 40% still comes from, at the national level, comes from non-institutional sources. And interlocking refers to when you have the lender who gives money or gives inputs on credit, then ask the farmer to supply back the harvest to him from which the payments are deducted. So there's serious interlocking of credit and output market, input and output market, and sometimes in the case of tenants and lenders, even credit and labor markets. And if you'd be shocked if I share this case with you, that there is this state called Punjab, which we all talk in terms of agriculture development and prosperity and modernization and so on. There is an issue of direct payments to farmers, which is hanging fire for the last 20 years. When FCI or CCI or any government agency buys from farmers, the payment is not made to the farmer. Even today, when I'm speaking, it goes to somebody else in that somebody else's name, even though the farmer has sold her produce or his produce. That is called Artya. And that is because of interlocking. And three governments have come and gone, but this issue has not been addressed. And when I tell my student, the class, that who should get the payment, they laugh and say, sir, why not anybody else, only farmer? So, but this is the kind of thing I'm referring to. This is the kind of political economy of agriculture markets we are dealing with, which needs to be sort of understood clearly before we talk about what to do, how to reform, and how much to reform. I will skip some of these things, but move on to the crux of the matter. I also pose this question to people around, that is it this crisis we are talking about or distress we are talking about only in agriculture? It's a part of the larger agribusiness sector. If it is a part of the larger agribusiness sector, we include from inputs to processing, retailing, and marketing of produce, then why only farmers and farm workers are committing suicide or getting indebted? Yeah? So we need to examine this. Therefore, I say that there's money in agribusiness, but farmers don't have access to it, do not have a foothold where money can be made from the farm produce as it moves along the value chain. The other issue I have with this understanding of agricultural markets, a lot of agricultural economists look at producer share in consumer's rupee. This methodology has been used for so many decades, but I find that it's now outdated. Because today, even if you look at fresh produce retailing by supermarkets, there is value addition taking place there as well in terms of cleaning, grading, packing, and so on.
Pleasure to meet you, sir. I'm one of your admirers.
No, no, sir. Sure. So if we recognize that there is value addition taking place by different stakeholders within the value chain, then we cannot be asking for very high share for the farmer in the consumer rupee. You can't be talking in terms of 70-80% share of the final consumer product going to the farmer. You have to have more reasonable assessment of farmer benefit in a value chain. And also many times we don't look around to see what are the possible market outlets for farmer produce. I generally throw this challenge out on the audience saying that whenever we talk about market outlets for farmers, theoretically there could be 6 options for the farmer to sell her produce. And I say that even in India, in most of the places, you could have at least 3 channels available to farmers, provided you are market conscious. Only thing is, we don't try the market institutions of working for farmers, do not try adequately to explore markets for farmers. I will not go into details of that. I have listed there what are those 6 options which can be thought of. The challenges are in terms of that Indian agriculture is aging in terms of farmers' age. Average age of an Indian farmer is above 50 years now. New people are not interested, youth are moving away, a lot of people are leaving agriculture because it is also about modern skills. If you're today talking about organic or fair trade or ethical trade based farming or global gap certified farming, it is not everybody's cup of tea. You need to understand the market and then do that kind of farming. Also, there is this issue of economies of scale and scope, which I have already dwelt on, is saying that farm size is not an issue. What we need is the post-production helping out of the farmer in terms of creating platform where farmers can buy together and sell together, both in terms of better bargaining, better quality, better prices, and so on. So that's where I think a lot of the crux of the problems of agrarian sector lies. So one can specify the Indian agriculture's constraints in terms of 3 aspects: assets, the resources, the markets, and institutions and policy. I would place the biggest emphasis on institution and policy, because you can't do much about assets, you can't do much about markets beyond a point for the individual farmers, but you can have markets manipulated in terms of the collective dealing with them. I would skip this part on focus on agriculture in terms of doubling of farming, a very welcome change in terms of moving from producing more to seeing whether farmer is able to get something out of it. Because I personally feel that farmers and farm workers' food security is as important as other segments of the population. And now let's get down to the issues at hand, which is what are the challenges facing agricultural markets in terms of policy and practice. The government of India, for the first time in 2003, tried to give a model APMC Act, the Wholesale Markets Act, whether grain markets or perishable produce market, fruits and vegetable market, dana mandi or sabji mandi, saying that times have changed, we have new demands on agriculture markets, both from processors, exporters, as well as fresh produce retailers. Therefore, let's look at providing farmers more options. That act provided for direct purchase from farmers without going through the APMC mandi, private wholesale markets being allowed to be set up by private stakeholders and entities. I was told yesterday that Maharashtra has already 50 private wholesale markets which are operational. Many other states have given many licenses. Contract farming, which was illegal earlier, was made legal. And all this happened at the same time when agriculture continued to be a state subject. It still continues to be, and that's one of the policy issues in terms of how much role the union government can play if states have to ultimately carry out these amendments at their state act level, which may be 29, 30 different acts of different states. Now, as I said earlier, we have new stakeholders in wholesale markets, whether it's cash and carry players like Metro, or food retail supermarkets like Reliance or Birla's More, or Namdhari's, processors, exporters, and another new entity called farmer producer companies, which Bihar, I'm sure, is making a big deal on in terms of organizing very many producer companies, and one of our students from IIMA is involved in a big way. Very happy to note that. So once you have these new players, both on the back end and the front end, you need to do something about making this market deliver to the requirements of these two stakeholders. We have other things happening. The Warehouse Receipts Act. Act is there since 2006, but not many, not even 1,000 warehouses are accredited for getting loans against the farm produce for the farmers. You have organic farming and organic product standards. We had APIDA's standard for organic earlier for export. Now we had national program on organic production. We had national standards, but it doesn't recognize natural farming. There are a lot of areas in India which are into natural farming now, which is beyond organic farming. But the act doesn't emphasize, still doesn't, Food Safety Standards Authority of India does not recognize naturally produced foods and fibers as something which can be sold as per its regulations. Now, what is the issue? Issue is that when you don't have markets working efficiently, it compromises the efficiency of both the buyers and sellers in terms of higher wastage, high cost of procurement, or high transaction costs of selling or disposing of your produce, quality losses, lack of quality-based pricing, and many other things. And the experience of corporate involvement this since 2003 has been very varied across states. I will talk about it briefly if I get time about it. And what do we learn from that? The other big thing which is happening around states is that in the name of very high wastage of perishable produce called fruits and vegetables, many states have started delisting fruits and vegetables from APMC Act. I have been arguing against it. I am saying that don't throw the baby with the bathwater. You need to use this as an incentive for the newer players to come into these markets, so waive the market fee for those who would like to go to farmers to procure directly or who would like to undertake contract farming. Don't do it as in a blanket manner, which doesn't help anybody. So basically, state is losing revenue, and those guys are just not going anywhere near the farms. I would not get into the issue of foreign direct investment in retail, whether it can help farmers, how much and how. Now, this is the table which tells you that if you modernize the, this is what the argument of those who say that if you modernize the Indian supply chains or value chains, then consumer will have to pay 8% less and the farmer will get perhaps 12% more. So both the parties benefit. Therefore, there is a win-win for everybody involved. But I have my own views on this. The benefit to consumer is 6%, and the other side is, I think, 8%. Yeah. So that's what is being claimed. So this is being done because it is argued that now farmers are deprived of benefits of quality input supply and remunerated prices because corporates are not able to link up directly with farmers because of APMC Act. And agro-food industry suffer due to non-availability of quality, adequate, timely, and cost-effective raw materials. Therefore, we are not even able to export competitively because you don't get the quality materials at reasonable cost at right time and right place. So all this is leading to the arguments for more efficient agribusiness markets and value chains, food safety being paramount, then sustainability of the farmer in terms of economic resource use, in terms of chemical input use, degradation of soil and water resources, and of course, the social component. How do we carry vast majority of India's farmers who are small and or marginal, 85% operators, along with us, so that they are not excluded, they're not left behind. So you have this picture I show everywhere saying that when we come to food safety, we don't want to go to the farm to tend to it, but somebody has designed a machine which claims that you can wash fruits, vegetable, and meat of all the chemical residues that in your kitchen. And it's selling like hotcakes across the country. Now, this is the state of affairs in terms of how our markets look. These photos are from Azadpur Mandi, the biggest wholesale market for perishables in Asia. This is what happened there. Most of the perishable produce markets are not regulated. Grain markets are much better regulated, but not perishable produce markets. And that leads to a lot of issues in terms of quality and quality-based pricing or costing or whatever. And more importantly, because we are looking at food safety, the issues of hygiene and convenience, because we talk about good agriculture practices on the production front, but when it comes to markets, we don't talk about good agriculture marketing practices. So we need to talk about good agriculture marketing practices at the same time when we're talking about good agriculture production practices. India is one of the few countries today which doesn't have its own India gap or Indy gap. Chile has Chile gap, Thailand has Thai gap, Mexico has Mexico gap on the lines of global gap, but we don't seem to be anywhere there. Now let me come to the policy part of it, how we are trying to regulate and promote. This Model Act 2017 for the first time has changed the very title of the act. It used to be Agriculture Produce and Market Committee Regulation Act. Now it reads as Agriculture Produce and Livestock Markets Facilitation and Promotion Act. So the assumption now is that we don't need to regulate because farmers are capable of dealing with markets. I disagree on that. I think still there's plenty of role for regulation because now you have bigger players coming to deal with farmers directly. And how come when Bihar deregulated the agricultural markets, I felt very sad about it because how can you say that farmers don't need any regulation in agriculture markets? In the absence of regulation, how can they hope to get a good deal in terms of not only prices, but also for the first time when I visited Bihar after this deregulation, I saw farmers being charged 2% commission in vegetable markets on roadside sheds which private had created. Farmers generally are not supposed to pay any tax commission to the Arthya, but here the farmers were being charged commission of 2% when I last time visited here, just to look at what happened after the deregulation and abolition of the act. So commission agents, which I said earlier that because the interlocking of markets, I have very different take on that, but commission agents are retained as a very central figure in this model act as well, that they will do all that. They will collect the payments for the produce and pay to farmers. I somehow feel that if in 2018 we are still talking about farmers not being able to deal with FCI or CCI or any other direct buyer, then we are living in a fool's paradise. So I think the time has come to do away the institution of commission agents. One of the states did it in 85. Nobody wants to talk about it. Madhya Pradesh abolished the commission agents in their act in 1985. And now no state is willing to look at this. We have producer companies, we have cooperatives, we have PACs, Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, they're procuring food grains through PACs, through FPOs, through FPCs, and even farmers groups. So if farmers can sell directly, where is the need for a commission agent to come in and do this? And all the interlocking, which I talk about in terms of credit and inputs, is all informal, illegal, it is not provided under any law. So all that business is being carried out. They have a license only to carry out the facilitation of buying and selling of farm produce. But most of the commission agents do this interlocking, and that puts everything into a problem. So the issue, another major issue with the APMC, APLM Act 2017 is that it has changed the domain of what APMC can do. It says it would not regulate marketing of notified agriculture produce in its delineated market area, but only in principal and sub-market yards. Incidentally, contract farming has been brought out or taken away from the APLM Act, saying that there is a conflict of interest, that the trader or the commission agent would not like contract farming to happen because that produce would not come to the market. Many states have also exempted that produce from mandi tax, and therefore they would lose their market. They will not get the commission on that. But the act has conveniently ignored another very major conflict of interest, which is the private wholesale market. In fact, there is a much bigger and direct conflict between the commission agent or the trader in the local APMC and the private APMC operator. That's why in many states licenses were given, but not many mandis could be operational because these guys didn't give them the land in proper place. They imposed mandi fees on them. They imposed many other charges on them. So I say that if there is a conflict of interest issue in regulation, then we should have taken out the private wholesale markets out of the APLM Act, not necessarily contract farming. Because contract farming is still taking place in most of the states at some level. So this is how you need to look at policy. Yeah, then the other thing which it does, for example, it says that the APLM will take measures to prevent sale purchase of produce below MSP. I think this we are just messing up with over-regulation here. I don't know, you would have read the Maharashtra example. This has come from some of the farmers' representatives and unions and NGOs saying that farmers don't get MSP. Therefore, every buyer who buys from the farmer should pay at least MSP. And Maharashtra went ahead and carried out an amendment in the act saying now even private traders would have to pay minimum support price when they buy from farmer. The traders went on strike. They had to withdraw within a week. My take on this is that if the government of India or any state government has promised MSP to farmers, why should you penalize the private trader? What is the fault he has or she has committed that he is being tied and being hanged for this? The state has committed to provide MSP by backing it up with procurement. The private has not committed. So private should not be asked to pay or mandated to pay MSP. I've told this to farmers union. They agreed. They said this was a blunder on their part to raise this issue. They should not have gone into policy making. But it's already gone into policy making. So there are other many things. I would not spend too much time on that. Come to the Contract Farming Act, rather, which is the which is here. That Punjab did something in 2013, which was that it didn't amend the APMC Act because of the political economy of Punjab's agriculture markets and various lobby groups playing their own roles. So they said, okay, we want contract farming, but since we can't amend the APMC Act, we would have a separate Contract Farming Act. So the union government has picked up that model and said, now we'll have a separate model Contract Farming Act. Punjab never operationalized it. Even today, it's not operationalized. They created a superstructure which was very, very costly, which was like the Chief Information Commissioner's office. So I argued against this when it was being drafted that no, you don't need to have a separate act on contract farming, but this has been taken through. The rationale being given is that this to avoid conflict of interest, which I talked about earlier, and also 5 to 10% lower transaction cost for the buyer. So everybody would be interested in picking up farmers' produce. It also makes crop insurance part of the contract farming arrangement, which is a good thing. But it does away something very beautiful in the 2000 Act, which was that there were some mandatory and some optional provisions of the Act, which has been now removed. The problem with this, the committee which designed, is that it goes overboard in facilitating contract farming, as the Act has a provision for the producer even leasing out her agricultural land to the sponsor lessee. Now, this is actually overstepping your mandate, because contract farming by definition does not involve cultivating land, even if it is not owned. That is corporate farming. So by stating this, actually the committee has gone ahead and say, okay, even if you do corporate farming in the name of contract farming, that's all right. So this is the kind of issues which one faces when one looks at this. And then it talks of Contract Farming Promotion Regulation Board, which would not only popularize crops under contract farming, but also promote the markets for these crops in export and domestic markets. How can a regulatory body do this? It's the job of promoting markets and promoting different products is not the job of a regulatory body, but this has been also provided. That shows that there is a shift from regulation to facilitation, and it's going really overboard in promoting that kind of shift in the policy. So my issues with this act are that there is a poor rationale for separate act on contract farming. The Contract Farming Model Act is silent on many important things like delayed payments to farmers, delayed deliveries of perishable produce at the factory or collection center, contract cancellation damages, production risk sharing other than crop insurance, tournaments making farmers compete with each other, which happens in US and is banned there. It is happening in India also, but we have not taken note of that. And more importantly, group contracts. If you have smallholders, I somehow feel that only way to work better with modern players on the buying side is to have group contracts. The act doesn't even mention group contracts. There is a country next door called Thailand which leverages contract farming for agriculture development by providing it in their national development plans for 10 years. It is called four sector cooperation plan, saying private companies, farmers, agricultural cooperative bank, and the extension department work together to provide better market interface and facilities of extension and credit to the contract growers. It was written in their plans, and they said that we would only encourage group contracts because farmers are small. But here we just don't seem to be worried about that. So if we look at the experience of contract farming so far, I have done some 36 case studies of contract companies and crops across the country, across states. Farmers' production risk is generally not shared. Prices are still based on open market prices, including for organic produce. You only give 5%, 10%, 20% premium. If we say that our APMC is not good enough in discovering a good price, then how can you use that price, badly discovered price, to give your price to the farmers as contract price or direct purchase price? All the food supermarkets are doing this. When Reliance or Birla procure from farmers, they go by the previous evening's APMC prices and add a few paisa more to that to procure from the farmers next day from their registered contract growers. The contracts have been highly one-sided. Small farmers have not been part of these contracts most of the time except one or two crops like gherkins or to some extent maize. The other big thing which is very worrying, which is happening from a larger perspective, is that contract farming is leading to a lot of reverse tenancy. That since small and marginal farmers are not preferred suppliers by those buyers, and they don't have the resources to invest on the farm for global gap and other things and so on, they end up leasing their land to medium and large farmers. So operationally, the land control is shifting to the hands of medium and large farmers, and all the benefits of government programs actually flow to those farmers. The reverse tenancy is actually getting perpetuated with the practice of reverse tenancy and the contract farming. I don't even want to talk about other issues of child labor, gender, and so on, which goes on here. These are pictures from contract farms in Gujarat, in Punjab, and elsewhere. The workers are not even, I somehow say that since Indian agriculture is largely feminized now, the women workers are the sheroes of this sector. They do most of the work on the farm, but when it comes to paying minimum wages, we don't care. No state implements minimum wages. Surprisingly, Gujarat, for the first time this month, has lowered minimum wages instead of increasing. Generally, minimum wages go up, but it has been lowered this time. So I think we need to also talk about those who don't have lands, but they are the real workers on the farms. Go beyond farmer to small farmer, to tenant, to worker. Tenants, we have seen the Andhra Pradesh experience. Nothing much happened even after giving those licenses and so on. So this is what the BT cotton, hybrid seed production, where you have plenty of child labor happening in North Gujarat. And all kind of things are related to that. I will skip the supermarket, but just show you this, that this is how supermarkets procure. These are pictures from their collection centers. It is no different from the way the produce comes to APMC mandis, sabji mandis. The same way it comes to collection centers. Only after they get their A grade, they take care of it. B, C, D, farmer has to take it back to the mandi or give it to the cattle as fodder. So this is the state of affairs. All kinds of means are being used. People are sitting on vegetable packs and so on. So there's nothing like quality and hygiene, which one can talk about. So I would now just come down to the last few points, which should be taken as the kind of, what is the way forward? I would say we should encourage or enforce more formal contract procurement from farmers. This contact farming or direct buying without any commitment on either side is not going to help in terms of better quality of production or better productivity or lower cost and so on. We should incentivize smallholder inclusion. In the past, there have been some schemes of the Ministry of Food Processing Industries and even some of the state governments which gave money away to contracting companies irrespective of the fact whom they worked with. You had to only show area under contract and get so many hundred rupees per acre and you are done. So if you want small farmers to be part of modern value chain, you have to say that only when you do group contract farming, only if you have so many percentage of farmers who are small, then you'll get some of these benefits. Link credit to contract farming, though not mandatory or exclusive. You can give lower interest credit from priority sector. Group contracts need to be incentivized and promoted. Fruits and vegetables, as I said earlier, should not be exempted from APMC rules. Only use them for incentive for promoting contract farming and direct purchase. Producer companies are the way forward in terms of helping farmers to deal with modern markets. I'm happy to inform you that yesterday, Madhya Pradesh has allowed the farmer producer companies to procure and sell anywhere without paying any mandi fee, without paying any commission. The buyer will bear all the commission, producer company will not have to bear any charges. And this year's budget, union budget, has already given tax exemption, income tax exemption to producer companies if their turnover is below 100 crores. For 5 years, they will not have to pay any tax. So there's a great opportunity for farmer producer company to get going to help farmers. But I would still say, whatever new channels we may have, direct purchase, contract farming, whatever, unless and until we reform the good old or bad old APMC mandi, we are not going to get anywhere so far as the vast majority of India's farmers are concerned. So free licensing for better competition should be given. Now, some of the licenses in some parts of India are being black marketed. A license sells for a few hundred thousand rupees each. You have to buy it in black. That's the kind of dominance of APMC committees on that. E-payment of market fee, ensuring open auction system, better facilities, representation of FPOs in the APMC management, and as I said earlier, denotification of Aadhtiyas from the mandis, and we should learn from Thailand experience of four sector cooperation plan, how much regulation? I put Bihar versus Gujarat. Versus Gujarat, I'm mentioning because when originally Gujarat amended its APMC Act, it said if you want to do contract farming, APMC would be a third party to contract. So we had some discussion. I said, why? Why should you want to get into a business transaction between two parties? So then they made it optional. So we have a case of MP. So we have very different levels of reforms, types of reforms, nature of reform being carried out different states, good or bad, but that's the reality of. So the state has to see what role it plays in terms of not only facilitating, but also regulating for the benefit of smallholders. The one thing I would say before I conclude is that we have had enough of production orientation in the farm sector. It's high time we talk about markets. We make farmers more market-oriented. We bring more market-based production practices on the farm so that we are not only competitive globally and nationally, but we are also able to give a decent livelihood to farmers and farm workers. Thank you very much.